like this, and he's here to see in person what it is we do. So just before they speak, let's give a round of applause to Jason Bergman. We are so glad that you could be here with us tonight, and thank you for all of your support in making all of our endeavors happen.
I agree with that statement. Actually, Jason let our team that I'm going to tell you about have a lot of fun. He took us boating. So thank you, Jason, for the support you show all of us in different ways throughout our conference. Basically, we want to tell you about our own Nevada-Utah Youth Rush. Both Ashley and I got to be part of our first program to come back to the Nevada-Utah area. So I got to talk to one of our co-leaders that will be here in about a week. And she's like, Heather, break it down, the who, what, why. So the who, for any of you guys, if you've been to any of our schools, they have a scholarship program. You can be a camp counselor, you can be a call porter, you can be a student missionary, but I want to tell you about being a call porter. So I can tell you that about 8 years ago, my brothers did this program, and it was life-changing. They found their wives, that I love my sister-in-laws, and now they have families, and they're pastors. Everybody is going to be called to a different vocation, but this can let you see what you want to do with the rest of your life. And the awesome thing about it, too, is that the friends that I made the last 4 summers I've done this, they are for life. When I see them, I want to run up and hug them because we have grown so much together. So the WHO is different conferences have call porting programs. And now, starting last summer in West Jordan, our call porter program came back to Nevada, Utah. Maybe some of you guys got to meet Yuani Sanchez when he was doing the recruiting. Well, he's going back to seminary, and Anthony Baca, that some of you may know, he's going to lead the program this summer. So we're just up here to tell you about it for him. And that's kind of what the who is and the what. If you guys have never heard of call porting, I'm going to simply tell you what it is. For 10 weeks, you dedicate your summer for an awesome job. You have Christian books, some of which maybe some of you guys grew up reading, and whether it's for kids or for the families, and you get to go door to door selling these Christian books. And you get to do it with a team of high school and college students. Like I said, by the end of the summer, you are going to have friends for life. And the awesome thing about it that my friend, my co-leader, reminded me earlier today is that you get to basically grow in your relationship with God as a team. You're not doing it by yourself. And at the same time, as you're growing and finding new things about yourself and God's plan for your life, you're also like sharing hope at doors. I will never forget some of the doors I would go to and the pain behind that door. And the family member like hugging a book to them and with tears because they needed someone to reach out and give them hope. So I want to turn it over to my girlfriend Ashley, that it was her first summer last summer, and she wants to share an experience that she'll never forget.
So my favorite experience happened in Northern California. It was a really hot summer day, and I was walking down the street going door to door, and this guy was waving me down from across the street, and he said, hey, do you have a Bible? And it was interesting because how would he know how to ask that? So I stopped and talked to him for a little bit. He's like, yeah, I really need a Bible. Do you have one? And I said, no, I have a lot of Christian books, though. Maybe you can take a look at some of them. And he took a look at some of them, and he said, well, how much are these? And, you know, I let him know, and he said, I can't afford these. And he just started crying, you know, going into why he couldn't afford these. And he'd actually his wife just left him with his children, and he hadn't heard from them in months. And my parents had just divorced, so I was able to relate to him right away. And it was a really special experience, and we just cried together and prayed together, and I just said, you know, God really loves you, and he really needed to hear that special day. And he said, well, what church do you go to? You know, I want what you have. And I just said, well, you know, it's not about the church, it's about having Christ in your heart, you know. And our leader came by to pick me up. It was time to go to lunch, and I gave him one of our books, and I prayed with him one last time, and we got in the van to go to lunch, and I told my leader, you know, this guy really wants a Bible. Can we please give him a Bible? And ironically, one of the boys in our car had just been given a Bible. So God planned everything out perfectly, and we were able to get this guy a Bible. And it really helped me to cherish my own Bible. So that was really one of my most precious moments over the summer. And one of the promises that I learned over the summer was 2 Corinthians 4, 6, and 7, if you guys want to turn to it. It says, "For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us."
Amen. And it was precious. Like, me and Ashley were friends before, but by the end of that summer, we are forever sisters. So last, I want to share a promise with you that was my first summer 4 summers ago. And something would play in my heart. When I'd be talking to the people at the doors, I would think of a parable that I grew up hearing, but it never really was personal to me. Remember the story of the wedding supper, and they're trying to invite people to come, and they're like, you know, I'm busy, I just got married, or like, I have cattle, maybe today would be I have a new car, or something like that. But they would all be giving these excuses, because we're all busy, right? And I remember God impressing me, Heather, just pray for them, help them to see what you have is the answer to everything that they need, and keep praying. And so I remember thinking, Lord, give me courage, and he did, because I, like, am shy, but he helped me be bold for him, because I knew what I had could heal their families and give them hope. So I want to share a promise with you, because if God is speaking to any of you right now, you have people praying for you in your conference, that they will call you by name, that God will call you by name. Those we need young people willing to dedicate their summer. And so if anybody's having this seed planted in their heart right now, please come talk to me and Ashley and my girlfriend Soshi. She's going to send a piece of paper around where you can put your info down. But please come talk to us, and we'll get you all the information you need. But there's one promise I want to share with you that God gave me the end of my first summer. And it says, "And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever." You guys have no idea how God is going to use you. I know he can use you in an awesome way this summer, but whatever his plan is for you, he wants you to be like a Daniel and an Esther for him in our generation in the 21st century. So I just want to say a quick prayer for you guys, and then we get to praise God together. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, it warms my heart to see all of these young people here. Lord, may you just talk to us personally what we need tonight through the power of your Holy Spirit. And I just pray for any of these young people that you might want to go out there courageously this summer, may you talk to them by name, and may they come talk to us. Thank you, for I know that you're going to do a very special thing in our conference with all the special opportunities coming up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church family, you guys look, wow, we got a full house. When I came in, it was empty. Turn to one another and say, "Happy Sabbath, and I'm glad to see you." Amen. We're going to go ahead and get into our praise this evening. If you don't know the words to this song, the lyrics are up there, but this is, as we get into praise, just take this time just to commune with God and ask that whatever happens here tonight, I know there's a blessing in store. My man Gerald is here. He's preaching this evening. I went to school with this cat. So I'm happy to hear what he has in store for us. So let's go ahead and jump into "I Am a Friend of God."
Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call?
Take it to the verse.
Is it true that you are thinking of me, that you hear me? It's amazing.
I am a friend.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. Friend of God, he calls me friend.
up there? You guys know the words?
That you hear me.
When I call.
When I call. Is it true that you are thinking of me? That you love me?
Song we're going to sing is How Great Is Our God. Can we put the first verse up, please? Does everyone know the words?
Kind of, pretty much.
Okay.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. Here
One more song, and it's one of my favorite songs. It's Holiness Is What I Long For. How many of you guys are sinners out here? But how many of you know that we serve a God that because of who he is, I'm saved by grace? And so as we sing the song, meditate on the words, and as we get into our sermon this evening. Thank you guys for participating, and we'll follow the program as it is.
So our first items after the praise team will be coming from Nueva Esperanza Church. And I know they're here tonight, and many of us are trying to read what's on the screen. Just pray for us. We're trying to buy a projector. Amen? Amen. So Nueva Esperanza, if you're here, I know I saw, okay, there she is.
Hello?
Mike?
It's Pastor, it's actually a mix. Yeah, it's a mix. We're not all from... And I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same. Because I know
Hello. We're going to be doing a dramatic sketch today. It's right there.
Happy Sabbath. We're having a little bit of difficulty, so it's going to take a while until they find out the music. Yeah, so. Yeah. Amen, yeah. How's your weekend today? Like, how's your weekend? So far. Like, yeah, you okay? Oh. So we're gonna let the next group go, right? Yeah.
That's all right. You guys will be next. Oh, there's the pastor. We're going to have the Ogden Spanish SDA Youth. Can you guys do your musical item right now? Is that a yes, a no? All right. Thank you.
Any technical difficulties, so I was back there trying to make sure they got it.
You are the God. there ever was. If there ever was a time for us to stand, it's right now. We don't have time to waste. It's so much is going on in the world. As a matter of fact, Romans 13 and verse 11 says this: it is high time to wake out of sleep. That means far too many of us are sleeping. We're laying down, and now it's time to stand for something, to stand for what is right. And I want to encourage you to take a stand in your life, to stop living life how you used to live it, to not fall for the same thing. As a matter of fact, if you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. Sometimes the shame of what we've experienced is what keeps us so low down to the ground.
You're gonna fall down. There are gonna be times even when you do not want to get up. You didn't want to do this sin, but you found yourself doing it. And then when it's all done, the guilt is killing you, and the shame is making it hard for you to raise your head.
We're ashamed of what anybody will say or think about who we are on the inside, or where we've come from, or even what our experience has been. And so we just want to stay away from everyone and just lay there as if we're insignificant. But on today, I want you to know that you are significant, that you can stand.
The Bible says, a just man falls seven times, and then he gets back up. The crazy thing about that is after falling so many times, you would think that he would not try to get back up again. But the big picture here is he's not looking at himself. His eyes are focused on God, and he's getting back up.
There's no reason to be ashamed. There's no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. So I invite you right now to take that stand, to get up off of the ground, to take your place, and to find your purpose. The world needs you to stand.
Good evening, everyone. It's good to be here. The Salt Lake City, this beautiful city that you have, this beautiful church here in Utah. I will say more when I get up to preach, but I don't want to mess up the worship flow. We've been having great worship thus far. Amen? Amen. So I don't want to mess it up, but I just want to let you guys know that there is a West Coast Youth Conference coming up, April 24 to April 27. Can someone tell me what the theme is for the West Coast Youth Conference? Stand. That's right. Can you say it again? Say, what is it? Stand. Turn to your neighbor and say, stand. Amen. That's what it is. We are for 3 days in Ontario, California, the great state of California. Amen, somebody. We are teaching young people how to stand for Jesus Christ for 3 days, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Well, I said 3 days, huh? Saturday, I can't count. 4 days, 4 days. April 24 to April 27, we're going to be teaching young people how to stand for Jesus Christ. There are going to be seminars on how to work. There are going to be seminars on how to minister through Facebook. There's going to be seminars on how, if you've come from a broken family, how to deal with those type of things. There's going to be seminars on how to evangelize, different seminars such as that. There are also going to be great guest speakers. We have Michael Kelly from the Mount Rubidoux Seventh-day Adventist Church. We have Greg Nelson. He's from the East Coast. But we also have someone, they call him the Ghetto Preacher. Y'all ever heard of the Ghetto Preacher? Come on, y'all. Y'all ain't heard of the Ghetto Preacher? We got Willie Romos that's going to be in the house as well. So we're going to have a good time in Jesus. It's going to be fantastic. Big Charlie Thunderbird Academy is going to be there. They're going to perform or minister two or three songs, their choir. It's going to be a great time. Now, for something like this, you know what? It costs money. It costs money. And I wish I would have gotten down here earlier to Utah, but I got the assignment late from the conference or whatnot. But I really hope that we could send people. I've been working with Pastor David Hall, your youth director. First of all, give it up for your youth director, Pastor David Hall, a hardworking man. Okay, listen. This is the way it works. I've been working with the leadership of this project, which I help out a lot. And for this conference, we have given this conference a reduced rate. No, you cannot tell anybody else. Okay, it's for the whole conference, not just for this city. I was just going to do it for Las Vegas, but I said, I got to do it for Utah. And next week I'll be in Reno, so I also got to do it for the Reno young people as well. But for this conference, we have given you guys a reduced rate. So listen, this is what I want you guys to do. After service is over, please come see me. There's information there at the booth. I want to let you guys know. Some of your pastors know about it. Pastor Hall, of course, knows about it. The pastors are here, Pastor Arturo, Pastor Sheldon, they know about it as well. And we want to bring 100 people. How many people did I say? 100 people from Utah Nevada Conference. And I think it's very possible. Las Vegas, we had a great turnout last week. Tonight, I see all these young people here. I know that money might be a factor, but let's see what we can do, you know, to come to California and to learn how to stand for Jesus Christ. I got this young man right here. I just met him. His name is Lino. Lino, come on up. You got to know Lino. If you know Lino, give Lino a hand, pray. Now, listen, I just met this young man. He was telling me that he was in San Diego when they had it, 2008. Now, let me say this. West Coast Youth Conference, this is the third one. 2003, it was in Anaheim. 2008, it was in San Diego. And now it's going to be in Ontario. It's where the both unions, Pacific Union, North Pacific Union, all the churches come together as one and for young people, and we have a great time. Lino, please just quickly tell the audience, tell the church family some of the things that you enjoyed about coming to San Diego in 2008.
Well, it was just a wonderful experience, you know, an unforgettable experience. Delbert, come up here, man. You got to tell us something about it, too, because he went.
Oh, okay.
He went out there, too. You know, we did a community service. You know, we spiritually, we were, you know, yeah, feed it. And it's an experience that you will remember for the rest of your life.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, amen. Let's give him a hand. He remembered it as soon as I said West Coast Youth Conference. He said, "Oh yeah, I was there in 2008." And we are going to have another community service project. It's going to be a blast. I'm telling you, young people. Saturday night, there's a great Saturday night activities, I should say, basketball, games, just hang fellowshipping. I mean, it's going to be great. So I want to let you guys know to please come see me so we can talk in a little bit more details. Pastor Hall knows about it. Pastor Arturo knows about it. Pastor Sheldon knows about it as well. But please come see me after service is over, and let's talk more about that. I want to get from Utah, from Las Vegas, we're going to have about 25 or 30. Are you guys a better city than Las Vegas, Nevada? Are y'all better than Las Vegas? Shaky. You got to be proud of your city now. You got to be proud of your city. But I want you guys, let's see how many young people we can bring from the Utah area. Amen? Are some people interested in this event? Are you interested? Is there an interest level? Well, please come see me afterwards. May God bless you. Let us continue on with the worship service that we've been having. To God be the glory.
Amen. And so we're calling up the West Jordan group to come on up and to do their numbers for us, after which we'll have the introduction of speaker. And I know I don't want to preempt any other special introductions, but I do want to welcome our president and his wife, President Antisier. I know Jason was welcomed earlier. Could you just please stand for us, Mr. Treasurer? I want everybody to see our treasurer, see the look of prosperity on his face, and our president. Mr. President, please stand again, sir. And his beautiful wife, Sister Rhonda Antisier, could you please stand, give us a little wave? Amen. We're happy to have you here tonight. And we want you to make a whole lot of noise for our president. Amen? Oh, Lord, I just said a whole lot of noise. Come on, folks. Put your hands together for our president. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Okay, yeah. Happy Sabbath, guys. I am blessed to be here tonight to open the Sabbath with you guys. I am excited for the word, I'm excited. We are the West Jordan Samoan youth. This is not all of us. This is just some of us. First off, we're going to start off with a old item. It's from the hymn. It's called "'Tis So Sweet." And let me just... Okay. I hope you enjoy. Sign Me Up, and this one's actually the whole youth is coming up.
Thank you. testing. I think we ought to say amen again. Praise the Lord for such a rousing rendition. And I want to say, before we get into the introduction of speaker, for all those that have participated on the program thus far, and those who are yet to come, thank you so much. It is not just one of those things, you know, you come, you sing, here today, gone tomorrow. It's not that. But tonight, you utilized your talents and your skills for our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. You cooperated with God tonight to create the type of environment where His Holy Spirit could freely flow. And I thank you for that. Tonight is one of those nights that make me feel very proud to represent this area in this part of our country as your youth director. And I thank you so much. I thank all of you that have come out tonight. I know you came eager for a blessing, and I can hardly wait to see what Jesus has in store for us this evening through the spoken word. Our speaker, you've heard him a few times, but now as an official introduction is Pastor Gerald Thompson. He is the father of two sons, ages, if I'm wrong, you will tell me, 10 and 5. 10 and 7. I knew it was. I was close. Ages 10 and 7. And these these two young men are the apple of his eye. When he talks about his sons, you just see him transform into something else. But I see that same glint in his eye when he talks about his Jesus. And when he talks about how he would like to introduce and reintroduce as many young people as he can to the Jesus that set him free so many years ago. He is the pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Palm Springs, California. Hope Community, Hope Community SDA Church in Palm Springs, California. And for the next three weekends or the three weekends in March, he has graciously agreed last week in Las Vegas, this week here, next week in Reno, to come to our conference and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we thank you for it. And we pray that God will continue to enhance your ministry. I found him, as we've just met just several weeks ago, I found him to be a true brother in Christ and a friend and a basketball enthusiast. Amen. So after special music, the next voice you will hear will be that of God's man for this time, Pastor Gerald Thompson. Hear ye him.
So, as you can see, not all my youth is here, just me and my sisters.
Test.
And we plan to do a different song, but the pastor said we're not singing a different song. We're going to sing this song, so please bear with us as we sing. We're just going to try to praise God tonight.
Test.
And I'm going to ask Hanita to come up.
And not fail. though the vision is only for a while, it shall speak and not laugh. For if the Lord said it, you can count on it, he will do just what he says. Write the vision, make it plain that they may run and not faint. Though the vision is only for a while, it shall speak and not lie. For if the Lord said it, then you can count on it, he will do just what he says. It is so. Yes, it is so.
How many of y'all believe that Jesus will do exactly what he says? Oh God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you, Father, for this great occasion that young people from all over Utah can come together on a Friday night, Father, opening up the Sabbath. Lord, they could be anywhere else, but Father, they made a decision to be right here on this occasion. Oh God, I know that there are some people who are antsy, Father. They are trying to leave. Their cell phone is blowing up and text messaging is going on. But oh Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you will rebuke the spirit of distraction right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father, every heart and every mind, oh Father, will be connected to you to hear exactly what you have for them on this evening. We thank you, oh God, for what we have already heard, Father. And now, Lord, we ask you to take us a little bit higher. Lord, we ask you, oh Father, for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to be felt on the hearts of everyone under the sound of my voice. Not for my glory, not for the glory of Pastor Hall, but for the glory of Jesus Christ. For, Lord, you live, and you reign forever and ever. And Father, we come here to worship you. So Lord, forgive us for our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We pray for the precious blood of Jesus Christ to wash away our sins and give us clarity and understanding of the word that you have for us this evening. In Jesus' name I pray. Let everyone say amen, amen. To God be the glory. Great things he has done. I just want to begin. I want you guys just to give yourself a hand praise for what God is doing in your life here at Utah, Nevada. To God be the glory. I must first start off by thanking the pastor of this church for allowing this great event to happen. We go back to about, I think, about 2000, 2001 when, really, he was in California around that time, and I got into the ministry a little bit about 2005, and we've been connected ever since. So God bless you, Pastor Sheldon, and to your beautiful wife who is here. Let's give them a hand. Praise the pastor of this church and also the other church. To my brother that back in February 25th, I believe. Well, we talked February 23rd. And for the first time, and when we talked, it was as if we were just best of friends. We had a great conversation together, and that 2 days later, I was out here, and we had a chance to meet, and we sat down, and we ate at Sweet Tomato. Is that what it's called? Sweet Tomato. We ate at Sweet Tomato, had a good time together, and went to the Hispanic Youth Rally out there in Las Vegas, Nevada. But I just have the utmost respect for your youth director, Pastor David Solomon. Isn't that a powerful name? David Solomon? Pastor David Solomon Hall. Give him another hand praise. He's a wonderful, powerful man of God, and to your family as well. To the leadership that's here. You know what? I want to start with the treasurer. I didn't get a good look at him, but I think Elder Jason, am I correct? Elder Jason, that dressed up. You know, he looked like a treasurer. He dressed up so sharp. To God be the glory. I have the utmost respect for treasurers of our church. It's a lot of hard work. Because of my degree, people have thought that I would become a treasurer, but I said, Elder Jason, I said, no, that's not for me. That's not my calling, but to God be the glory. God bless you so much. Let's give him a hand praise for the work. You guys don't know, it costs. You need a person of integrity to handle the finances of the church and of this conference. And to your president, I thought I heard that he was here. He may have stepped out. I had a chance to meet him. Is he still here, President? Is President Larry, is he still here? He may have stepped out, but to God be the glory. God bless him. I'll be with him in his home down in Reno, in the area, I should say. But you have a president. You guys got to understand the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the structure. Presidents are very important to this church. And you have a president who loves his family, who loves young people, and who loves this conference. So you know what? Pastor Sheldon has said it earlier, but even though he's not here, let's give your president a big hand praise. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You guys are probably thinking, is this pastor just going to keep us clapping the whole night? Maybe so through the word of God. But I got two more people I gotta give a shout out to my girl Toby, man. It's so good to see her. Don't be booing her. I haven't seen her since I left Texas. We went to school together down at Southwestern Adventist University. She's a good I'm not gonna put her on blast, but it's been a while since I've seen her, you know. But much love to you. Good to see you. You still got a sweet, beautiful voice, and you're doing just a good work. Let's give Toby a hand praise. And then, you know, Pastor Hall has a son that's a great basketball player, and he and I were talking last weekend about his son, and he just motivated me because, you know, I used to play ball, and I could have made it to the Lakers, but if it wasn't for the Sabbath, ain't that right, Big Charlie? I'm gonna holler at you in a minute, Charlie. But I went out and I've been playing a little bit, but I went out on Monday or Tuesday, and I didn't really, you know, warm up like I should. I'm a little bit older now, so I need to warm. It takes a little bit of while to warm up, but I was out there. I was playing hard. I was crossing over, shaking, and I was doing, you know, 360s and stuff. My back went out that night, and even right now, my back is still hurting, but it has been so, I've been energized by the music and by the Holy Spirit that's here.
I got to give, you know what, I love people. You guys don't know me from anywhere. The only couple people in here know me, but those who know me or who's getting to know me, I love the ministry, I love Jesus Christ, and I love people. And you know what, my boy is here. I'm from L.A., and, you know, I have a slang to me sometimes, but I just keep it real. My boy is in the house, and, you know, Charlie, man, Big Charlie, just wave your hand, Big Charlie. Oh, man, I don't know if y'all know Big Charlie, but, Charlie, it's a good dude right there. Now, let me tell you, me and Big Charlie, we go back to Thunderbird Academy. I've known Charlie since he was 15. I was about 17. We're about 2 years apart. He came to Thunderbird, man. He's still part of my crew even to this day. Charlie, it's good to see you, man. Much love to you. You know what? Let's just give him a hand praise because I'm asking y'all to give him a hand praise. He has a beautiful family, beautiful wife and two kids. Big Charlie, man, you don't know how much it means to me to see you tonight. Really, it does, man. Let's get into the Word of God. Let's go to Daniel. If you have your Bibles, go to the book of Daniel, your phones, your iPads, or whatever it may be. Let's go to Daniel chapter 3. Now, let me say this with all due respect to my young people. I'm so proud of the young people. I really am. Now, I'm asking you to look at your phones just for the reason to look at the text of the scriptures. Somebody gonna get me in a minute. Not the text of your friends, but the text of the scriptures. So that after we look at this scripture here, y'all put down your phones. Amen, somebody? Oh, amen, amen. Let's go to the book of Daniel. Chapter 3. What verse did I say? Amen. Hey, but Pastor, Preacher, we know, Preacher. I want the young people. That's right, Daniel chapter 3. Let's go to verse 16. I just need three verses. You know what? One thing I'm loving about this church right now, is that clock is wrong. Amen. So I don't really know what time it is. Amen. Daniel chapter 3. So I could be here all night. You know, I'm a black preacher from California. We preach for a long time. Amen. So, you know, so listen, I will know how I'm doing by the amens. If it starts to get low, that means I need to sit down. But if it's high, I'm going to keep on preaching. No, let's go to work. I won't keep you too long. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 through 18. That's all I need. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 through 18. Shadrach, Meshach, and who, everybody? Answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. May the Lord add a rich blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word. I have entitled our message for this evening, Fireproof. Fireproof. Now, let me stop right here and say this to all the older individuals that are here. There is a movie called Fireproof. It has to do with couples. And you know, getting back together. Let me tell you something. I thought of this sermon title before that movie came out. Amen, somebody. So I don't want anybody to think Pastor Gerald is plagiarizing. This is my title. Hey, I think they might have gotten this title from me. Amen. Let's go to work. Watch this. We know the story well. We have heard this story many a time. But on tonight, you're going to hear it a little bit differently. And I pray that people make a move to come to Jesus Christ. This is what took place. This great king, Nebuchadnezzar. Now, I don't care what anyone says. Nebuchadnezzar was a great king. He was one of the best kings, one of the brightest kings. And this king, Nebuchadnezzar, had a dream in Daniel chapter 2. And he saw this big image. And they had to interpret the dream for him and all these things. But then he got a little bit arrogant. The problem that Nebuchadnezzar had is that he was too into himself. The problem that some of you young people have, you are too into yourself. Get out of yourself and get into Jesus. Amen, somebody. You stop thinking you all that because you got some pea flyers on or you got the skinny jeans on. I don't know if y'all still rocking skinny jeans. This is California. I don't know. But I'm here to tell you, get out of yourself and get into Jesus Christ. You are nothing without him. So now this great king, he thought too much of himself. So he built a golden image, and he said, everybody in Babylon and all over, you need to come and worship this image. But wait a minute. It wasn't just like that. You come and worship. You come and worship. He said, no, when you hear the what, everybody? When you hear the music. I pause right now to say this. Is that the devil just does not come to you boldly. He just don't come up in your face and says, worship me. He gets you, young people. He got me too for a little bit. He gets you by music. The music that was played at that time, it did something to them. And it made them move and worship a golden image that they know that they should not have worshiped. Let me tell you, music, young people, make you do things that you should not do. I got a friend of mine who used to gangbang, and he told me, he said, you know, we were talking, he says that before he does something, you know, before he goes out and shoots, or he goes out and commits and does some things against the other members of another gang, the territories, he says that he will go, first of all, he'll get high. He'll get drunk, and then he will go and listen to certain music. And in that music, the music, he will hear spirits talking to him through the music, telling him exactly what they want him to do. I'm here to tell you that music, this hip-hop, is getting to the minds of the young people, and it's crippling you from hearing the word of God. Right now, somebody got Jay-Z in their head right now. I see you, man. So right now, some girl got Beyonce in their head right now. Some brother got Beyonce in their head right now, too. I see you. I'm here to tell you, you know what? Don't get caught up in those things. We ought to remember that music is not about worshiping the devil, but music should be about worshiping Jesus Christ. Sign me up! The songs we should be singing, those songs that we heard on this occasion should be ringing in our heads, not only on the Sabbath, but all week long. Amen, somebody. I'm here to tell you, I'm not here to bash the music industry, because I was once there. Big Charlie will tell you, I knew all the songs, and I still know some of them today. It makes me mad. That's just the other day. I'm trying to get the music out of my head, y'all. I'm trying. But just the other day, I was at somewhere by my house, and I was, because I don't live in the best part of town, but I live in the okay part of town, but they blasting that music, and I was driving, and I heard a beat that I haven't heard in many years. But you know what? As soon as I heard that beat, I knew the song. And you know what? My kids caught me slipping, because I started rapping some of them words. Oh, Holy Ghost, help me now. I'm here to tell you that music will get to you, and it will stick to you. But you know what? It makes you do things that you should not do. Get that music out of your head and fill it with the music of Jesus. So now what happened was they listened to that music and they bowed down. And the king said this, listen, look at the type of king this he was. He says that if you don't bow down, whoever does not bow down, I will throw them into the fiery furnace. Let me tell you something. Anybody who tries to put you in a box, you need to step away from them. God does not do this. He is saying that if you don't do this, then this will happen to you. Let me tell you, we serve a God who allows you to worship him in freedom. He wants you to worship him not out of force, not out of fear, but out of love. God is a God of love. This king is a God of hate. And of God of fear, trying to put fear in people. And he said, if you don't bow down to me, then I will put you into the fiery furnace. Then we got these three boys. My three homeboys. Can I talk to you for a moment? We got these three homeboys named Shadrach, Meshach, and who? Are y'all with me? Wait a minute. Let me talk to y'all. Now listen. What I do at my church is that when the people are not responding to me, I preach longer. So if y'all know certain answers, y'all better answer that question loud. Now there were three brothers, three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and who? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And as everybody was bowing down, they stood straight. Now y'all got to get the picture. When everybody was bowing down, they stood straight. Now, make sure you get this, because you know how some of you try to slip and slide in, with your Christianity. Oh, one foot in and one foot out. You try to slip and slide. They didn't even act like they were picking up their keys. Are you with me right now? When everybody bowed down, they didn't like try to get down, try to fit in. No, they stood straight. I'm here to tell somebody you need to stand straight for Jesus. Stop trying to slip and slide in your Christianity experience, trying to be over here and over here. You need to stand for Jesus. So they stood up, and the people saw, and they called and said, King, you got these brothers here. And you know, they were close to the king. And then the king Nebuchadnezzar got so upset, he called them over. He says, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you are doing these things, that you are not bowing down? Y'all better stay with me. I know you heard this before, but watch this. I'm about to show you something. Watch this. He says, is it true that you're not bowing down? And they say, yeah, we're not going to bow down to your God. Who you think we are? Are y'all with me right now? I got to excuse my hermeneutic approach, y'all. You know, I'm from the inner city, y'all. So that's what we got to say. I'm not bowing down to you. Who are you? I got a God who loves me and who will protect me. And he's saying the king Nebuchadnezzar got so mad. Listen to me. Got so mad that he heated the fire seven times hotter. And on top of that, he killed some of the men, some of his own men, because the fire was so hot. Let me tell you why so many people are in jail today. Because they lose control of their temper. Oh, y'all didn't know I was going there with this story. Watch this. Some of you right now got bad temper. I'm talking to you young people right now. Some of you got a bad temper. Some of you will, in a minute, you be ready to fight. In a minute, somebody look at you the wrong way, you ready to throw down. In a minute, somebody says something to you, you start want to curse them out. Let me tell you something. You need to learn to control your temper. Because controlling your temper will save your life and somebody else. King Nebuchadnezzar lost his temper. King Nebuchadnezzar lost his cool. So as a result, he killed his own men. And he put these people in the fiery furnace. Now here's the drama. Here's the drama. You know, National Geographic or the History Channel, one of them, they're showing the Bible. The Bible, or Discovery, yeah. They're showing the Bible all, y'all know about that out here? Y'all know about that? Some of y'all? Yeah. Every Sunday evening, I don't know what time it comes out here, about 8 o'clock, California time, around that, they're showing the Bible. Let me tell you something. Motion picture cannot paint what the Bible has. You need the Holy Spirit to show you what took place. Now, this King Nebuchadnezzar is here. The men have been thrown into the fiery furnace. Are y'all, you know what? This is the, if you don't shout amen, I'm going to shout for you. Because this is the best story in the Bible. One of the best. How in the world can three men be thrown in the fire and not one of them get burned? Not one of them come out smelling like smoke. You know, back at Thunderbird Academy, you know, we were big on cooking ramen noodles, you know. You know, I don't know if y'all have been to boarding school. Big Charlie know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? You know, Thunderbird Academy, you know, we don't have a lot of, you know, you have some food in the cafeteria. Yeah, I have a story. I can't share that with y'all. I might get in trouble for that story I'm about to share about the cafeteria anyway. But listen, you got the food in the cafeteria. And at that time, I wasn't a vegetarian at that time. So I just wanted to eat, you know, some real food. So I'm hungry late at night. You know, I would have to go in and cook some ramen noodles. And, you know, a couple of times, because I'm not the best chef, Toby, but a couple of times that I was out, when I was in there, you know, I might have turned the heat up too much, and, you know, things start boiling too high, and things start getting too hot, and then sometimes fire might start coming out. And you know what? I've been hit by the fire. And you know what happens when I get hit with fire? I get what, everybody? Now, don't try this at home, y'all. Don't try this at home. Don't try to go underneath the fire and think you're not going to get burned. No, you need the power of Jesus Christ. Now, watch this. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar is here. The fiery furnace is here. King Nebuchadnezzar throws these men in the fiery furnace. And as they are in the fiery furnace, listen or read the words of the king. He stands up. He was sitting down. He stands up. And he looks. And he says, I threw in three, but I see four. Let me get my glasses. Can I play with this for a minute? Y'all with me? Y'all with the pastor right now? I'm just having a little fun with this, y'all. Just stay with me. You know, when you can't really see something, or you see something that you can't believe, you start doing all these things, trying to figure out, is it really true? King Nebuchadnezzar, yes, it's true. But that's not it. He says, and one, y'all be missing this part of the story. One looks like the son of. Here's my question, Bible students. How in the world does this heathen king, this king who doesn't believe in Jesus, this king who doesn't believe in God, this king who does everything opposite of what God says, how in the world does he know what the Son of God looks like? Knock, knock, you there? Watch this. Here's a word for somebody out there. I don't care how far you've gone from Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is still pulling you. You know what? In the world today, we always want to talk about other people. People who are not of this faith, or people who don't believe in Jesus Christ. Well, I'm here to tell you, stop talking about them and get down on your knees and pray for them. Because you never know what God is going to do in someone's life. In Daniel chapter 2, when there was this big statue that he saw, and the statue, there's so much prophetic interpretation, I'm not going through all that. But what happened at the very end is that there was a rock. The rock that came, and when he saw the rock, it is stated, and it is proven from the scriptures and from Ellen White, is that King Nebuchadnezzar saw the second coming of Jesus. So watch this, a heathen king. Jesus did everything that he could do to try and save him, so much that he showed him who he was. Had Jesus showed himself to you, and he showed who he was. So when he looked into the fire, he says, I've seen that face before. When he looked into the fire, he said, I've seen this man somewhere before. When he looked into the fire, he said, I know what this man looks like. And he looks like the Son of God. And he got up. He said, pull the brothers out. He pulled them out. There was no smell of smoke. There was no burnt on their clothes. Jesus did what only he could do. Amen, somebody. And he rescued them from the fiery furnace. Well, I got three reasons for you. I got three reasons why Jesus, what made these three boys fireproof. Well, it's in your Bible. Let's go to the Word of God. Number one, the first reason why that these Hebrew boys were fireproof is because they were focused. Go to verse 16 of Daniel chapter 3. Are y'all with me right now? Wait a minute, are y'all with me right now? No. Hold on. Are y'all with me right now? Yeah. Turn to your neighbor and say, fireproof. Fireproof. Turn to your neighbor and say, fireproof. Fireproof. Now watch this. Turn to your neighbor and say, I want to be fireproof. Three ways. Here we go. Number one, the way that you will be fireproof, and the way why they were fireproof is because they were focused. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16. The Bible says this. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. You know what? These boys, they were focused. They weren't about playing games. You know, sometimes when people ask you what your religion is, you try to say, well, I'm a... What you laughing for, brother? What's so funny, sister? You know what? You stand up for who you are. You know what? You say that I'm a child of God. I believe in the power of Jesus Christ. I keep the 7-day Sabbath. Are somebody with me right now? Now, I know that we are a minority here. But you know what? I've been a minority all life, and I don't really care. Someone asks you who you are, you stand up and say that, you know what, I'm a child of God. I believe in the second coming of Jesus Christ. I believe in the seven-day Sabbath. I believe that he's forgiven me from my sin. I believe that no matter what I've done, he can bring me back. I'm here to tell you, let somebody know who you are. Learn to be focused. Stop playing games with your Christian experience. These boys were focused. Number two, the second reason why they were fireproof is because they were faithful. It's obvious. Verse 17. If that is, you know, I don't know what kind of books y'all be reading in school. I don't know what kind of books y'all read at home. But I'm here to tell y'all, take the time to read the Bible. They got some good stuff in here. Listen to the conversation, that dialogue that these men are having with the king. You know, we get all, you know, I used to, you know, living in California, I've seen actors, you know, many times. You know, I'm from LA. I live in San Bernardino, and my church is in Palm Springs. You know, there's, you know, if you know the area, it's different. But at any rate, but growing up in LA, I've seen actors on the street. I've been to games, basketball games, and I've seen them and so forth. And I used to get nervous. You know what I'm saying? I used to get nervous. I talked to some of them before. I took a picture with some of them before. I used to be nervous. You know, why? What am I nervous for? I'm saying they don't have a heaven or hell to put me in. Somebody better get me right now. You know what I'm saying? They can't do anything for me. They might be able to give me a little bit of money, but I don't need their money because I got a mansion that's already paid for me. Amen, somebody. So look at the dialogue that they're having between these three men and the king. They say this, verse 17, if that is the case, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king. Let me tell you something. These boys were faithful. I'm here to tell you, we need a generation of young people who are going to stand up for Jesus. We need young people who are going to be faithful, this, even though the heavens may fall, even though they're going to put a gun to your head. It does not matter. You need to be faithful unto death. They said, it doesn't matter, king. It doesn't matter what happens. Even if we do die, even if God decides not to spare our lives, we still won't bow down to your sorry. They didn't say all this, but I wish they would have said this. You know what I'm saying? To your sorry image of gold, because we're not worried about that gold, for I got a mansion up there, and I got a heaven that has streets that are paved with gold. Come on, somebody. They weren't worried about those things. They were faithful. How many faithful young people do I have in this church tonight that will stand up this no matter what happens? They'll put a gun to your head. I don't care. They'll put you in jail. I don't care. It does not matter. Your parents might kick you out the house. It does not matter. You stay faithful to what God has asked you to do. Amen, somebody? Amen. Number one, to be fireproof, you have to be what? Focused. Number two, to be fireproof, you have to be what? And lastly, I'm about to let you go. Number three. In order to be fireproof, you must not be a follower. Watch this. Verse 18. Daniel chapter 3. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the gold image which you have set up. It is hard to prove, but some of their friends, these three Hebrew boys, they bow down to the golden image. Y'all better listen to me now. People that they were connected to bow down to the golden image, but they were not followers. They were leaders. Young people, stop following the crowd. I was watching this this documentary on gangs. Just a, you know, just trying to get my mind on certain things, different things like that. There's a certain gang, I'm not gonna call it. But I was watching a documentary on these things, and you know what? The whole thing comes down to this, is that they are needing some, people are needing, hope y'all listen to me. Wait a minute. Y'all better listen to me now. Shh, pay attention. Mom, I'm about to let you go, but listen. There are people who, they want acceptance. They just following the crowd. You know, and this in the last days, you're gonna get the mark of the beast in your head and in your hand. And there's some, there's it's about following. If it's in your hand, you're just following. I'm gonna tell you, we need young people who are gonna be leaders. I need young people. Pastor David Hall needs young people here in this conference who are not gonna be followers of people, but are gonna be followers of Christ, who are gonna be leaders, and they're gonna stand up for what is right. If you want to be fireproof, you need to have focus. You need to be faithful. And you need not be a follower of people. Now watch this. I'm about to show you this. One more thing. Are y'all still with me out there? Watch, I'm about to let you go. I just got to show you one thing. For all my theologians that are in the house, you'll understand what I'm saying. There is what we have learned to be called theology, which is the study of God. But the deepness of the Bible is not so much theology, but it is called Christology, which is the study of Jesus. Everywhere I go, I always make sure, if you have never heard me preach, I always make sure and make sure people understand it. In every part of the Bible, you can always see Jesus, huh? You can see, you may not see his name until the New Testament, but in the Old Testament, you see Jesus. So here's my question. This is a very easy question. Where is Jesus in this story? Where is Jesus in the story? It's easy. Somebody say, who would have said that? He's where? Where is Jesus in the story? He's where? He's where? He's in the fire. Isaiah chapter 43. Let me show you this and I'm going to let you go. Jesus is where, everybody? He's in the fire. This is for somebody out there right now. Isaiah chapter 43. Jesus is in what, everybody? He's in the fire. Isaiah 43, verse 2. Y'all with me right now? Here we go. The Bible says this: when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. I want to let somebody know that right now, God is with you. The Bible says he will never leave you nor forsake you. So when you are in a fiery storm of a bad relationship, Jesus is there. When you are in a fiery storm at home with your marriage breaking up, Jesus is there. When you are in a fiery storm at school, people picking on you, Jesus is there. When you are in a fiery storm with your financial situation, Jesus is there. The Bible is clear that he will never leave you nor forsake you. So if you're in a fiery storm right now, well, let me tell you, don't worry about it. Don't stress. Know that Jesus is standing right next to you, and it makes you fireproof. One night, Big Charlie, I was in a place I shouldn't be. Down in Texas, Dallas. You know, I know better. And you know, think about it, young people, you know better too. I was in a place that I should not be. And I've been in places like this before. You know, when the music is loud, people dancing. Y'all know what I'm talking about. All these things going on, alcohol is being passed around. All these things are going on in a place I shouldn't be. And you know, we always want to scare young people to say that when they go certain places, Jesus is not with them. Well, I discourage that thought. And here's why. Because to my older saints out there, you have not always been perfect all your life. In fact, you're still not perfect now. And even in your mess, Jesus is standing with you. So I want to let some young person know under the sound of my voice that I'm not advocating you going out to certain places. I'm not advocating you do these things. I'm advocating that you stand for Jesus Christ. But I'm here to let you know that if you do fall, that Jesus can pick you up. That if you make a mistake, Jesus will bring you back. And I was in this place that I should not be. And shots rang out. People started fighting. Things started getting chaotic in there. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. And I'm there scared for my life. No, I should not have been there. No, I should have. I just came from church. It's a Saturday night. And I know that I should not have been there. And I'm praying right now. God, help me. Lord, save me. Things are going chaotic. It's getting crazy in there. And you know what? You know what? Next thing you know, I find myself preaching. Amen, somebody. I'm here to let somebody know that when you are in the fire, good fire or bad fire, that Jesus is standing with you. And why is he standing with you when you're doing bad things? Because he wants to bring you back. And why is he standing with you when you're doing good things? Because you are fireproof. So I want to let you know that there's going to one day come a fire. Mm-hmm. Not water, but fire next time. And I want to know, young person, when that fire comes, are you going to be fireproof? Oh, Lord, in the name of Jesus, as this praise team, as the praise team gets ready to sing, shut them, go play. We're going to play that song, Holiness. Praise him. Come get ready to sing. Lord Jesus, we come to you, Father, right now as we just finished going over one of the greatest stories in the Bible. And Father, Lord, we have heard these stories many a times in our Christian experience through children's story, through reading it ourselves, through Sabbath school, through the preached word of God. And Father, sometimes we miss the certain things that are found in the story. But Father God, my plea tonight is that these young people, that everyone under the sound of my voice will become fireproof. To know the power is not in the music. To know the power is not in other gods, lowercase G-O-D, but to know the power is in Jesus Christ, our Savior, our only hope of salvation. So, Father, as we transition into another part of this service, I pray, oh God, that you will work on the hearts and the minds of the people. Soften the hearts of these young people. Lord, as the call is getting ready to be made, and Father, they will accept the call to be fireproof under the power of Jesus Christ. Song is being sung. Here's my first question to you. It's a general appeal right now. Everyone under the sound of my voice, if you want to be fireproof under the banner of Jesus Christ, if you want to be fireproof under the protection of the cross, if you want to be fireproof, it's a general appeal. If you want to be fireproof, stand to your feet right now. If you want to be fireproof, sing that song, Holiness.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for.
Yes, I long for.
Holiness is what I need.
It's what I need.
Holiness, holiness is what you want for me.
Hold one for me, hold one for me, hold one, hold one, hold one. Listen, God wants us to be holy. God wants us to live for him. And you know what? Everyone on the sound of my voice, you know that. But you know what? You're trying to do it by yourself. You're trying to do it on your own. But I'm here to tell you, to be holy, you need Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ will make you fireproof. Here's my call. Here's my call as the song is being sung. If you want special prayer, If you need prayer, if there's something in your life that you need God to take care of for you, if you got a struggle with drugs, or if you got a struggle with some addiction, or you got a struggle with gangs, or with your temper, and you know that right now you're really not fireproof, and you need a better and a deeper relationship with Jesus Christ, and you want Pastor Gerald Thompson to pray for you, just come down forward so we can have that special prayer. Who are you? Just come. Sing that song.
Holiness is what I need. It's what I need. Holiness.
Come on. Come on. Come. Come close. Come close. Come on. Come on. Young people are coming. Come closer. Come closer. Come up here if you have to. Come up here.
It's what you are for me.
Pastor Hall, come stand up here with me.
So take my heart and form it. Take my mind, transform it. And take my will, conform it.
To your will. They sing this last bit. You guys know what you're coming down for. You're coming down because you got something in your life and you need prayer for it. You want to be fireproof under the banner of Jesus Christ, and we're getting ready to pray for you. But there's somebody who needs to be baptized or who needs to be rebaptized in this youth rally on this date today. You saying, Pastor Gerald, Pastor David, Pastor Sheldon, Pastor Arturo, Elder Jason, to the leaders, I want to be baptized, or I need to be rebaptized. And as they're singing this last part of the song, if that's you, just step forward right here. Give me your hand and give Jesus your heart. Don't be afraid. Stand for Jesus Christ, who tonight says, I need to be baptized. I backslid and I need to come back, or I need to be baptized for the very first time. Who are you? Where are you? Come, give me your hand and give Jesus your heart.
Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for.
What did I long for?
Faithfulness is what I need.
Who are you? Where are you? I'm looking.
What I need.
Are you right here?
Faithfulness.
If you are, come on.
Faithfulness.
Say you need to be baptized. Who are you? Somebody?
It's what you want.
Is there somebody baptized or rebaptized? Who are you? What young person do I have?
My heart and for me.
Who are you? Where are you?
Take my mind, transform me, and take my.
Brokenness, brokenness, brokenness. Every head is bowed, every eyes closed. Brokenness, brokenness.
Brokenness.
Who are you?
Brokenness.
I'm getting ready to pray, but if there's somebody.
That's what I long for.
Last week in Vegas, we had a couple of young people. Don't be afraid to stand saying, I need to be baptized. I want to be rebaptized. Is there somebody else like that? Is there somebody?
Brokenness is what you are from me. What you want for me. So take my heart.
Anybody else?
And form it. And take my mind. Transform it. And take my.
Jesus. Lord, we have had an experience with the Holy Spirit on this evening. Lord, from the music, oh Father God, where the angels were singing, with those that stood up to sing, with the Holy Spirit who preached to us, even to me, Father. Oh God, all we can say is praise you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Father, there are young people. First of all, we have people just standing in the general appeal who says, you know what? When you come, they want to be fireproof. And I pray, oh God, on the sound of my voice that, Father, everyone in this building, everyone in this church will be saved because they believe in the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Father, these young people, people here are standing, oh God, because they've come closer, because there's something in their life. So, Father, I rebuke the spirit of drugs right now in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the spirit of gangbanging right now in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the spirit of alcohol right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray that you encourage someone's soul. They're going through a rough time in their home. Their parents are fighting, and their family might be broken up. And I pray, Father God, that you give them peace. Somebody is going through a where their family have just been divorced, their mom and their dad, and they're still hurting. I pray that you give them peace. Oh, Father God, I pray in the name of Jesus that whatever the situation is, whatever the problem might be, that you touch them right now. Lord, let them know that through their fiery storm, you are standing with them. And let them know under the power of Jesus Christ that we are fireproof. So I thank you for this church, for the pastor of this church, my friend, Pastor Sheldon. Continue to bless him and his ministry and his wife. Bless Pastor Arturo, Father God, out there in Ogden. Bless all the churches that are here. Bless the conference officials, the president that was here, and the treasurer, Elder Jason. Father God, give them wisdom and guidance. And my friend, Pastor Davis Solomon, a man of God. Continue to be with him, oh Father. Continue to keep him strong so that he, Lord, do your work. I thank you, O Lord, for this service. I thank you, O God, for this time in prayer. In the wonderful and precious holy name of Jesus Christ, let everyone say amen, amen. Give somebody a hug right next to you. Let them know that you are fireproof under Jesus Christ.
Take my heart and form me. Take my mind, transform it, and take my will, conform it to yours, oh
felt the presence of God in here this evening. What do you say? Now, I want you to realize that while we feel all warm and fuzzy inside because we've had an encounter with Jesus, not everybody is happy about that. And when you walk out these doors, the Nebuchadnezzars of this world will be there to try to attempt to throw you in the furnace again. But I want you to remember one thing. The Bible says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And if you keep that in mind, along with everything else that was said and everything else that was done this night, you will be fireproof. I believe it was not chance or circumstance that brought you here tonight, but I believe that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ knew what every single person needed to hear. So my prayer is that you will take what you've gotten from this youth rally and you won't keep it to yourself, but I pray that you will let your light so shine before men so that they can see your good works that'll glorify your Father, which is in heaven.
thank you so much for coming out this evening. It has been a joy to serve you in this capacity. Please save the date on your calendar, October 24, 25, 26, the combined youth, no, junior youth, and young adult rally. We have something for everyone. It will take place at the Mountain View Seventh-day Adventist Church in Las Vegas, Nevada, October 24 through 26. Our main speaker is Elder Gilbert Kanji. He is the World Youth Director, and he has agreed to spend time in our conference because he believes something is going on here. So we praise God for that. Save the date on your calendar, October 24 through 26. And Pastor Sheldon, you have some instruction for later. I'm finished.
Thank you very much. Praise God. Tonight I was blessed and challenged and encouraged. I'm happy that my church was able to see that there are black preachers louder than I am. And that's always encouraging. Amen. Always encouraging. So just want to say thank you to my friend Gerald, and we want to give you an opportunity after the service is over to just go out, shake his hand, sign up for the West Coast Youth Congress. And we do want to say thank you very much to all the churches present here. I did want to acknowledge one other person's presence, Sister Ayata. Pastor Pepe's wife, Sister Ayate, could you just please stand and give us a wave? She's always been a very firm supporter of what we do here. And I think, Pastor, your wife is here tonight, and your son. I just can't pick them out in the audience right now. I know they're sitting somewhere. Are they outside? She's right here. Come on, stand up, give them a wave, turn around. I know we'll be having Pastor Arturia down here in Salt Lake just a few months from now, and I'm excited to hear him preach for us, and we're going up to Ogden a couple weeks or a couple months from now, but I'm really happy to have each and every one of us here. There was a group that was supposed to sing, and some young people from my church that were supposed to do some stuff. We're not going to let them do anything tonight because my favorite part of the program is just about right now. We have some cookies, or I should say a cookie. And we're going to be praying that Jesus will be able to multiply the cookies. Amen? Amen. So we have some cookies. And for those of y'all who still believe in the health message, and you're saying, Pastor, we're boycotting the cookies, I'm going to ask you to turn in your excess cookies to me. Amen? I will use them. But we do have some vegetables and some other stuff for you, and a little bit of juice for you. Because we don't want you to leave just yet. I know it's late, but we don't want you to go too quickly. We want you to stick around, hang around, get to know some of the youth. We have Nueva Esperanza in the house. Come on, somebody. That was actually horrible. I know you can do better. We have Nueva Esperanza in the house. We have West Jordan in the house tonight. We have Ogden in the house. How about, who else do we have in the, huh? Oh, we have Talaki Mamani in the house. They're not very loud, but who else do we have in the house? Sunset? We have Sunset in the house. Who else do we have here tonight? My own church is in the house tonight? No, they're not really here. They're all over. But we're really happy to have each and every one of you here. And for those of you who've been looking at my shirt and wondering, Where can we get a shirt this wonderful? There are a few steps you have to take in order to get that shirt. First, you have to renounce your citizenship from whichever country you're from. And then you'll get one of these shirts. But we just want to dismiss you right now. And please do not leave. You do not have permission to leave until you get a cookie, okay? Nobody leaves without a cookie, all right? If you leave without a cookie, we will brand you a grouch. Pastor, you want to say a few things?
Just one last thing. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. And when you go back to your homes, just be sure and say a prayer. Ask Jesus to crystallize all that was said and just make it real. And wait. I want you to do one more thing, and then I'm done. I want you to ask Jesus, what do you want me to do with what I heard tonight? And then I want you to sit and listen and let him tell you. If you do that, it'll be all right. Have a great night. Thanks for coming out. God bless you.